Welcome to the 3 Gig Sports Podcast, where we are never wrong, but sometimes misinformed. This is Danny G sitting alongside Jimmer and Rio today, and holy cow, we've got a hell of a show for you. The NFL season is underway. We had some great college games this weekend. And before we go to news and notes, Jameis Winston on pace for 85 touchdowns and zero interceptions this year. Want to make sure we touch on that. But Jimmer, kick it over. What's going on out there, man?
So last few days are pretty news-filled, action-packed here. Jerry Jeudy carted off and ruled out after high ankle sprain. Fitzmagic expected to miss multiple weeks with a hip injury. He has an MRI for today set up to see if it's broken.
Damn.
Yeah, that one. Especially, that definitely takes my pick and plummets it. I mean, their defense will keep them around, in my opinion, will keep them around 500.
Yeah.
You know, the defense can do that, but as in a true contender, out. I'm not saying he's that level, but he needed a quarterback. And right. Taylor Heineke, you're up, player.
Get it.
Yeah, Rio, you're smiling too big here. The Cowboys have a shot now.
Yeah, it's still not them. It's still going to be the Giants.
Keaton, baby.
What?
Yeah, you heard me.
Oh, my gosh. They're so bad.
You heard me. Francisco Lindor hits 3 home runs and benches clear in Yanks-Mets game.
Let's go. Yeah. It's getting
Battle
intense.
For New York, right?
Oh, yeah. The Subway Series, baby. I like that shit. This is a big deal right here. So Scherzer records 3,000th strikeout in immaculate inning and falls 5 outs shy of a perfect game.
Dude's
in the same game.
Dude's a stud, man. He's going to go down as one of the best to ever do it. Dodgers, made that trade and ultimately got better. And, gosh, he's like, just a stud.
Like, is his stuff, like, actually that nasty? Or is it because the fucking batters are so focused on that eye? Like, that would intimidate. I'm not. Tell me that wouldn't intimidate the shit out of you.
Oh, man.
You come up there like, what the fuck is going on here?
No kidding.
Yeah, Mr. Roboto eye going on. Hawkeyes move from 10-5 after a 27-17 win over rival Iowa State.
Big time. I think if they can get some consistent offense, you know, throughout 4 quarters, they can make a push. Like I said, I had them finishing number 2, and Ohio State looks so
erratic.
Yeah, that, okay, maybe we can go big time here, and then the quarterback just overthrowing here. That they're going to leave the door open for Iowa's defense is so good. They could potentially win that thing.
Yeah. The defense is so good. I worry about the quarterback play.
I don't.
Because
are you kidding me?
Deucey's time to shine, baby.
Well, we know.
Deuce Hogan.
Guaranteed a few things come college football. Texas and Notre Dame being overrated and Iowa choking when the moment matters.
I was going to say, I thought you were going a different route. Like, hey, 3rd and long, fucking Iowa.
Oh, yeah.
3rd and 10,
also,
Iowa runs the
Kirk
rock.
Kirk Ferentz is going to run the ball on 3rd and long.
Right.
All right. And Rio, since you brought it up, let's go ahead and get this out of the way. For those of you listening, we had a whiskey wager on Texas and Arkansas. I had Arkansas
get it
to beat Texas this weekend. And what happened was Texas got thumped.
And yeah, bad.
Very disappointing.
Everything, you know what? Everything went so wrong in that game. Like, we were in it in the beginning, right? Like, offense couldn't move the ball. They muff a punt on, like, the 3. Dude's big toe is out who recovers it for Texas. It was just, like, one after the other. Couldn't get anything rolling on the offense, right? And it just continued to spiral. We couldn't move the ball, defense on the field. And I think he should have went to Casey Thompson earlier. He didn't until, like, late in the 3rd, who then led. I know he led 2 scoring drives. I can't remember if it was back-to-back. But I know he led a first one right away, and he may have stalled on the next one, but then scored another one. So he's got a quarterback battle on his hands.
So this is the inaugural whiskey wager, and Rio just so happens to be lucky enough to not only be the one to do it, but be the first one, because after this one, it turns into the
warm
whiskey wager. Because the more we discuss this, any whiskey can be half-assed tolerable when it's frozen.
Right.
So now,
Connor, what's up? Reach out.
Reach out.
Sponsorship, baby. Proper 12 coming in today.
Just that proper.
Just got that proper 12,
who the
baby.
Fook is this guy?
And to be clear, everybody listening, the reason Rio has to take the shot is because Texas is not ready for the SEC.
Ooh, hold on. You know, teams get blown out all the time in the SEC, right?
Not good teams.
Yeah, well, that's true. no, I don't think we're ready now. I said we wouldn't be ready this year, definitely. Wait for him to get his recruits in. I think we'll be fine. Get some recruiting on that D-line. I totally agree. SEC football, you got to win in the trenches, baby. So,
shots up.
Shots up. Ooh, ooh.
There it is.
There it is.
The first down. Official shot of whiskey. Way to hold it up. We'll have another one today. We'll figure out a bet, I'm sure.
I would definitely get some Mountain Dew down
there.
I'm
sure there's some ideas. But warm whiskey wager coming at you here from now on. But
getting it in, baby.
Yeah, good to see Texas get thumped. 333 rushing yards by Arkansas.
That's crazy. And no one guy had 100 yards.
Bonkers.
That is crazy. That's a crazy thing to me. Like, I knew our defense wasn't that great, right? And ultimately, it comes down to the offense, not moving the ball right and keeping defense on the field. But to not be able to, like, 300 yards, that's crazy.
Yeah, I've got to admit, I didn't think it'd be like that. I just figured Arkansas would edge it out. So.
Yeah, just one thing. Like, the 300 yards was just, you know, whipped cream on the top, cherry on the top, because, like I said, everything going wrong, you know, go down, block punt, then it's just the kicker misses a long field goal. It's just one after the other. Like, oh, my goodness.
What do you do? All right, since we interrupted you, what else, Jimmer?
We have Oregon, who moved from 12-4 after an upset victory over Ohio State.
Boys.
Even with freshman quarterback C.J. Stroud throwing for 484 yards. Still looked, when I was watching, it looked a little erratic to me. It didn't seem.
Yeah, he was off the pace. I think the game's a little too fast maybe. At this moment, how about going actually 4-0 on my college picks? At BYU winning, Iowa, Oregon, they were the 14.5-point underdogs, and then obviously my BYU pick to knock off ranked Utah. So,
yeah,
solid picks.
Kudos to you, my man.
Oregon is going to be a problem this year.
Yeah, their running back Vertel.
Yeah, they're talented.
And so let's. Think about this, too. They didn't even have arguably one of the best players in college football on the field on defense. Thibodeau.
Yep.
Never. He was out of the game. Right. So that's without beating a top team. Of course, we know Ohio State's offense was
arguably one of the best defensive
players.
I was going to say, I think he's been mocked
quite
often as number one overall pick.
Yep.
So
yep.
Definitely
there,
top
five,
right? That's going to happen.
So he's not on the field, and they still do this in Ohio, right?
Exactly.
Impressive.
Nope. Tough place to play.
Yep.
Oh, yeah. That place was rocking. I was watching that game.
Oh, yeah.
You know, one thing that we're – before I finish up here is that it was awesome to see football back, of course, you know, and you get some college, you get the pros. But I'm telling you, it felt so much more different and exciting watching these games with the fans in there and how loud these stadiums were getting.
We definitely saw the crowd play a factor. We've seen it game one, right, Virginia Tech. Oh, my goodness, that crowd was so loud, just getting after it, right, and they couldn't hear. So we seen it right away, and as soon as I saw that, I knew, you know, the crowd's going to be a factor this year.
So Miami holds on against Appalachian State, and a falling cat gets saved by the fans. I do believe that was a 15-13 game. Does that sound right? It was. It was a close game. Jacksonville State.
No, Miami Appalachian State, 25-23.
Okay, yep.
You got that.
Yep.
Okay.
Close,
so, yeah, two
close
points.
Though.
Very close. Jacksonville State with a Hail Mary win over Florida State.
Yeah. Man, I would love to be partying at that school that night. It would have been crazy.
Yeah.
That's obvious. You're going to prevent defense. How does the receiver get past you? That's what happened. That just a bad play. That shouldn't have happened at all. But props to Jackson State for pulling that out.
Yeah, I have anytime I see a Hail Mary opportunity, and you see these happen every so often. Aaron Rodgers, I mean, I'm talking about actually converting him. Aaron Rodgers done a couple of them. Kyler Murray. It's one thing that always shocked me. Why in the hell isn't the tallest goddamn receiver out there on defense? You know, yeah. the Patriots were never stupid enough. They would put Gronk out there.
Yeah, Gronk would go out and stuff.
Yeah, like, why wouldn't you? And
right, back in the day when the Falcons were relevant and were in games, they'd put Julio back there.
Yep. Just common sense to me. But as of right now, that's what I got.
Boom. Beautiful.
Yeah.
So half of the NFL is on pace to go 0-17, and the other half is on pace to go 17-0. There were some really good
games.
Except
for the Texans. Even with the victory, I don't care.
Hey, I want to call that out, too. I did call that potential for game of the week, and that turned out to be way more entertaining than anybody expected.
Yeah, we got to kind of give you a little pat on the back. There were some points thrown up in that game. Yeah. You know, I know you were fucking around joking with it, but
I'll take it.
I'll
take that call.
Yeah. There's some points thrown. That being said, with that particular game, it still more than proves me right. This quarterback can ball. And the moment you tell me you don't, you're over there shrugging your eyes. He threw over 300 yards and 3 touchdowns as a rookie on a shitty team where a coach doesn't know what the hell he's doing as a pro level coach, I should say. The moment your contract is up, or you can just do the Aaron Rodgers, you need to get the fuck out of Jacksonville. That needs to happen, as soon as possible.
Well, they need to see. Here's the thing: he's got weapons around him, so they need to get some kind of better O line, consistent defense play. You know, they got some pieces on defense, but obviously that line has to do better. Has to give James Robinson some running room.
How about some carries in general?
Yeah, right. He didn't even lead in carries, right?
I think too. Yeah, Carlos Hyde had 9 carries, but you have the weapons on offense, right? DJ Chark, Marvin Jones, Chenault. You got some guys, mm-hmm. so you. He's got some talent around him, but
they have some nice defensive pieces too. Actually, yeah. If you look at the roster, but the problem is going to be, when they got to pay the guys, what's going to happen?
Right. I don't know what their cap situation is, but absolutely,
it's always the most room in the NFL. Every time you look, every single year, they're going to trade these boys. They're going to kill this quarterback. They'll end up paying him if he wants to stay there.
Mm-hmm. Which is crazy because you know Jacksonville, obviously being in Florida, so your high life, you know, your social life and such is high, so why wouldn't you want to go play in Jacksonville? Right?
This is Jacksonville. If you're going to go to Florida, you're going to fucking Miami or something. That's
well,
why.
Still, I mean, it's...
No, I do get what you're saying. Yeah,
right,
you're
close to all those attracting places.
Well, one thing we've got to emphasize, too, with Jacksonville is the coaching situation. There's a lot of rumors out there right now that the players aren't having it with Urban Meyer. There's a lot of kind of ruffles in the locker room. Obviously, he's not making the best decisions. We've seen that even in game 1 a few different times.
Yeah.
I could see this just going downhill real quick, and they have to figure something else out.
Right. Body language is huge. As a coach myself, it's huge for people, I think. And you could just see it in the preseason. Like, he's just rolling his eyes and scoffing at plays and stuff like that. And it's, you know, guys on the team see that. And if you're not helping, you know, hey, all right, hey, guys, you know, we missed that, but that's all right. Y'all did, you know, you find something good. And, you know, and then I think you get a little more positive playing time out of everybody. And that's just not what we're hearing and what we're seeing out of these people. But I don't know. They're going to continue to be bad for a while.
Yeah, I was kind of an Urban guy, you know. I mean, like, the dude just goes wherever he goes, outside of pros now, but wherever he goes, he wins. He creates a program, he wins. That being said, I also kind of don't like him all at the same time. Because is this not also the same guy that when shit started getting tough and the NCAA started looking into shit, he bitched out and said, I have a problem? Or as in, like, I'm so stressed. My heart is beating on my chest. And then all of a sudden he goes up to Ohio State like a year later or some shit like that. And
yeah.
So I see. I don't even have to know the guy personally to know that I know it'd be a very good or very bad relationship. You're either going to be one of his guys and you get him or not. And that's going to create a bad locker room because you're not going to have 53 men that are your guys. You'll never have that. You need to try to be that for – or at least try to split it, you know?
Yeah, when you're winning as much as he did, you never hear about the bad stuff, right? You never hear about the problems that guys had in the locker room and things. Well, now that things are looking just real shitty in Jacksonville, things are starting to come out about the kind of perfectionist he was and the expectations he had, which are ridiculous. It's easy well, I shouldn't say easy. It's easier to do that type of thing with young men, with college kids who are moldable. But yep. you're dealing with grown-ass men at this point. You can't treat them the same way that you do the college kids. Right. And I think that's a big part of what he's running into right now.
Well, those college ones, I mean, he'd have his pick between 4 and 5-star recruits. And so all these boys would be – they would have to listen. Otherwise, a fear of not touching the field. You know right. why? You know why I may not touch the field? Because there's another 4 or 5-star guy right behind me.
Right. But when you're paying these guys, you know, millions of dollars – you get the higher ups above you going, hey, this guy needs to touch the field. We're paying him, you know, whatever the amount is.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. You know, and you know, at some places in his careers, you know, a lot of those games, you had the best talent on the field. So,
mm-hmm.
you know, the pressure off most of those games, except in, obviously, championships and such like that. Working our way down the scoreboard, Eagles and Falcons. Eagles thumped the Falcons 32-6. You know, I think the most surprising part was the Falcons just not putting up points here.
Yeah.
You know, the Eagles, I knew the Falcons defense wasn't that great. And that's mm-hmm. why, you know, when you're calling it pick of the week to be a high scoring game, I was like, absolutely, like
they're gonna have to wing it.
Yeah,
to
they're gonna have
to.
Yep, exactly.
The defense is gonna keep them out of
both
it
of
anyway.
The defense. Or yeah, I was like, both defenses aren't that good. They're gonna throw the ball a lot. It's gonna be a high scoring game, right? No, absolutely not. The Falcons could not move the ball. It was just awful. But the Eagles, on the other hand, marched up and down the field, which I saw happening because the Falcons defense is not good. So, but still surprising end of score.
Yeah, I didn't expect it to be a blowout like this, man. I bet the over. What was it? What was the over under? 48.5, I think, something like that, before the game started. 32-6. Philly surprised me. I don't know if it says that much yet because Atlanta's defense is terrible. If anything, it might say more about the Falcons' offense. Everybody kind of expected them to blow up, and they couldn't do shit against Philly.
I think too much expectation on Kyle Pitts to open the offense up. Russell Gage is a nice piece, but he's not another guy you want as number two, right, receiver. Real quick, here popped up, the Lions cornerback Jeff Okuda suffered a ruptured Achilles,
ooh.
So he is out for ooh. The year.
Well, it just helps him get to that number one overall pick. But no complete laughing matter, because Jeff Okuda was one of their potential
bright
up
young
and right,
stars on that defense.
Up and coming, so that's too bad. You know, that... Well, it looked like the Niners were kind of running the track meet out there anyway. So I mean,
yeah, absolutely. Jalen Hurts balled out, 3 touchdowns, 264, looking good there.
Devontae and Jalen Reagor both putting up touchdowns.
Yeah,
yep. So Dallas Goedert, wrong tight end for me.
Yeah. Next up, Steelers and Bills. The Bills controlled this game through halftime, right? 10-0. At half,
it just felt like it should have been.
Oh my goodness, it was just horrible. I don't think they ran the ball enough. You know, they were doing quarterback runs, and you know, up 10-0. I'm like, okay, you're going to run the rock, right, and pound it in, start burning some of that time off the clock, and they just did not do that. They continued to throw the ball. You know, big stop for the Steelers right away. They had a long kickoff return. Down into possibly the red zone, maybe the 30, on the Steelers' side of the field, and they end up holding them to 3. That was a big moment there in the game, kind of set the tone.
Yeah, I think this says a lot more about Pittsburgh's defense than Buffalo. Their defense is just as good, maybe better than they were last year. Josh Allen wasn't very efficient, 30-51. That's tough. No picks, so no real bad decisions there. But
Zach Moss, no a way. Healthy scratch.
Healthy scratch.
Healthy scratch. What the hell is that about?
I don't know. I had Singletary. I ended up starting him. He had 72 rushing yards. But, that was interesting when I saw that come across. You know, I ran to start Singletary right away because I figured he'd get a bulk of carries and looks, checkdowns perhaps, especially with that good front.
I was in my truck on the way back and to the house, and my son was sitting next to me, and he's telling me, "Oh, Bills are losing 23-16. I'm like, "Ah, come on, just you know, read the score right." I'm not in the mood. One of those things. I'm like, "Come on, just read the you have it flip flopped." No, Dad, look, You know, honestly, I was shocked. That's the reason why I had him as my one of my locks of the week there, and just did not see that one coming.
Yeah, we were right on Najee. You know, 45 yards on 16 carries, only 2.8 average. And, you know, that O-line not getting much of a push up there.
Yeah, I think, I mean, Big Ben didn't look great. He had, what did he throw, one touchdown, 18 for 32, not even 200 yards. And Buffalo's defense is okay.
Only two sacks for Buffalo. Only two sacks. That's crazy. You know, he showed a little bit more movement in the pocket there than I thought.
Yeah, maybe
took a little bit for them to get rolling.
Further than we thought, you know.
Well, I mean, everybody forgot, and including myself. But I mean, they were 11-0, right? They ripped off 11 wins last year before everything fell apart. So maybe they're not as bad as we think they are. Well,
I think that was more Bills down than Steelers up.
That was, you know, just not performing well. On that, we'll roll down again to the Vikings and Bengals game. Not good. That was actually a really good game. I did watch a bunch of that.
I'm going to tell you right now, no team, including a Patrick Mahomes-led team, is going to come back and win with 10 shoot-yourself-in-the-foot penalties in the first half. And, like, I do believe it was like six or seven of them were pre-snap.
That's tough.
Just so I'm not even close to kidding. They started the game with 5 straight penalties. I don't know if you've seen that. 5 straight penalties. I think it was like the five first plays in the game.
No, I thought the Vikings were gonna wrap this one up. So I was watching the Bills and the Steelers. So I didn't watch this one until second quarter, I think.
So I do believe our run defense needs to work on a few things still. Old boy still went over 100 yards, Joe Mixon. The air defense was – I mean, the defense was there. Like, it doesn't look like that. 27-24 was the final score, field goal in overtime. They gave up 20 of those points in the first half. Like I said, when they're punting the ball nonstop. Yes.
It was 14-7 at half.
21-7.
It was 21-7 at half.
This is what – I'm just reading the box score here. It's saying – 14-7.
No. Where are we at? Up here. Let me go and scroll up. Oh, yeah, I guess. I thought it was 20.
Yeah, it must have been real early in the third.
Early when they got the other.
Okay.
Just that being said, though, the defense doesn't look like that, but when you punt that many times and they got, like I said, they only gave up 6 points. Yeah, they only
in the fourth and then OT.
That don't feel right. I'm pretty sure. I think this is off.
No, I think that's right because I believe it was tied, and then they got the ball back with short time, drove the field to take a touchdown, and then got the ball back at halftime, and then went down and scored again.
Okay.
So I think that's why, and they went up by 2 scores there, and then Vikings answered, so.
Yep.
That is right.
All
right. I remember because I watched that and coming out of half. So
back to just flat out Kirk Cousins being Kirk Cousins.
Statistically, good game. 351, 2 touchdowns.
Yep. It's always going to look like that with him. His stats are going to be there. Right. His percentage is usually going to be there. He watched a game. He was not on target at all. He threw probably 4 passes behind a receiver.
Mm-hmm.
He should have had some picked. That being said, when I say this, I'm going to say the offensive line was bad last year, okay? And it's been bad the last couple years. This game was nowhere near as bad to me watching as it was me being pissed off at Kirk Cousins. There's many, many, many times on his pass drop that I was counting. I was like, Jesus Christ, he had all the time in the world quite a few times. Okay, every so often you have to take one side step to the left before you throw. That's called an NFL rush. That's not anything unbearable. He screwed over his offensive line more than he in any way, shape, or form than he ever helped it. So when you hold on to it that long, I'm sitting there yelling at the TV as a Viking fan. I'm like, throw the fucking ball away.
Yeah.
If it's not there, throw it away.
You know, I think your offense is going to be fine, just fine. It's that defense that you're high on is you know, almost 150 yards, and Jamar Chase just burning Breland.
Yeah, that chemistry between those two is here, right? Like,
I don't know. They must have put white stripes on the ball or something. I don't know, because Jamar Chase went off.
They had a way newer ball. It was way weird. What I mean is, even after giving the ball back so many times to them and giving them every opportunity, Joe Mixon, yes, it was technically a respectable 4.4. It was 29 carries for 127 yards. I mean, that's what I'm getting at. 261 yards, that many possessions feels like it should have been. It felt like they had 500 yards. That defense played, besides a busted coverage, there wasn't anything huge. It was just opportunity. Many, many opportunities. I mean, you get many stabs at it. So,
well, the long bomb to Jamar Chase for a 50-yard touchdown.
That's what I mean. I said besides the busted coverage.
No, he just got flat out beat. That wasn't busted coverage. He outran.
No,
Breland.
No. Did you watch that play?
He ran by Breland. Breland, it was man coverage.
Yeah, it's called a busted coverage because he just stopped. He didn't even try to run with him.
Oh well, he got beat, I think, and was playing. I pulled a hammy.
He did not do the bipolar hammy. Goddamn. Either way, thank God I've always been a Rams fan. So
yeah, there we go. Me too, buddy. Matt Stafford looking amazing last night. Hey, of course, it was the Bears.
On one small positive, at least, even with still getting a loss the good old-fashioned way of losing to a Cincinnati Bengals team, might have found a kicker.
Yeah, dude.
53 yards.
Yeah, 53-yarder, man.
Tying field goal to put it in.
To put in overtime.
After watching that replay, though, I still don't think that Dalvin Cook fumbled.
Yeah, they said the replays were highly questionable. I didn't see it until replays. It does look like he's down when he fumbles that. Also, I didn't see the Justin Jefferson. They said he was in on the touchdown, too.
I heard that one on the radio, and they were shocked. Yeah, like, as in the radio announcer was shocked by it. They're like, because he's like, You know how Paul Allen talks if you have heard him. He's like, Dan, touchdown or not. That's exactly how he said it. He's like, and they're both like astonished. So I didn't get to see that play yet.
Right. Replay official dropping the ball. Yeah. Replay official. I mean, it's official.
The way it should go is if it's that close of a play at the goal line, they should just call it a touchdown and it's automatically reviewed instead of wasting somebody's challenge.
It automatically is reviewed. So
that's what I'm saying.
Yeah,
right.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Right. They should just call it a touchdown. Then.
Yeah, error on that side instead of the other. But it's still – so we challenged it. Somehow, they still said no touchdown on the Justin Jefferson. I don't understand that. So there were some questionable calls, but it's fine since he got the win. Another glimmer of hope is everybody in the NFC North is
0-1.
So we've got a shot.
So now we're going to go ahead and lead into the Packers.
Yikes.
And
– yeah. Also, another yikes. That one was tough to watch.
38-3. You alluded to it at the beginning of the episode here that old boy's on pace for, 85 touchdowns and zero interceptions?
Yes. Jameis Winston.
Jameis Winston. 148 yards. Only 14 of 20.
So, looking at this, I'm going to tell you right now, we talked a little bit off air here, but I'm going to say, I really do think this is his way of trying to get out, like right now. I think they already done flat out pissed him off. If you watch the pregame show, he sits down with Aaron Andrews and he says it a few times in so many words. He's like, you know what? I was in this mindset. I was ready to retire if I wanted to, you know. At one point I was like, you know what? I don't really want to do this, you know, it kind of in so many words like that. But then he's like, they drafted Jordan Love, play him. So I think he's actually doing this like as a jab. Like, when was the last time? I don't have it in front of me. That'd be a crazy stat. Because I guarantee it's very, very few. How many multi-interception games Aaron Rodgers has thrown in his career? He had two against the Saints.
Yeah. Definitely.
I 38-3 and got benched. Or whatever. Pulled himself, whatever you want to call it, you know. But.
Mm-hmm.
It just, I mean, Aaron Rodgers didn't help the situation, but this Saints team with the limited talent that we've been talking about without Michael Thomas, the stud they have is Kamara, right? They dropped 38 on that Packers team. So even if Rodgers is playing well, it's at least maybe at best a close game, right? Jameis Winston, I think, man, this is only game one, but Sean Payton might have figured it out, man. You limit the amount of throws he has and just make them more efficient. I mean, 14 completions, five of them. So a third of his passes were touchdowns.
Yeah.
This dude, hell of a coaching job right now after game one. But, man, if that defense keeps playing this well, they might end up being a problem.
So instead of touchdown to interception ratio, we're talking about touchdown to completion ratio?
Yeah.
That's impressive.
That is insane.
I don't – so I do not take this game. I was going to chat about overreactions. This could be one of them right here. I'm not leaning any which way on either one of these teams. I still think the Saints are going to suck. Yeah, this is still Jameis at the end of the day. It really is. That's in my opinion.
Right. Packers defense not great. Like I said, Jameis didn't throw for many. Kamara didn't go for many yards.
And then Aaron Rodgers doesn't play like that. Right. So it ain't going to happen. It's not going to continue. One thing I did forget to mention to you guys, evidently, and this is very Sean Payton-esque, I like it. I don't like Sean Payton. I hate the Saints. But
Bounty Gate.
Yeah, Bounty Gate. Bitches. But he picked this stadium to play in. You know why he picked the stadium?
Yeah, because it was the most expensive for Packers fans and get to, right?
No, it was the most difficult to get there because you don't just get straight shoot to Jacksonville. So it was the most difficult for the Packers to get to that stadium as far as the rest of the stadiums you could have been to or city you could have been into.
Yeah.
That's great. I love that.
Yeah.
I don't agree with it. I think it's easy to overreact. Mm-hmm. What my point is about Jameis is I think Sean Payton's got the right idea. You limit his passes because he could easily throw 5-6 interceptions in a game, right? So you limit his pass attempts and you just try to make them more effective. He's not going to throw 5 touchdowns a game, but so far the strategy, it looks solid. That's where I'm at.
Well, they had – so that's what I was looking at. Yeah, okay. So 60 plays. I thought it was going to be even less than that. So, okay. No, but I get what you're saying. I don't think that's how the season's going to land like that for them, though. That'd be ideal. I think that's what he'd want to do. He wants to keep the ball efficiently in his hand and out of his hand. Like, control, like, how many he's actually throwing so you don't have the Jameis Winston of old.
Yeah.
But I don't think it's going to happen that way throughout the season.
I don't think so either. I think it just kind of went, you know, Aaron Rodgers playing like crap. He's not going to play like that every time, right? He's going to keep his guys in it.
So over under Jameis Winston, 85 touchdowns.
Definitely under.
You know, I got to take the under.
Whiskey wager. Danny's trying to get a cheap whiskey wager here.
So I'm going to go. I'm going to go ahead and say it. If he throws 85 touchdowns, he's throwing 85 interceptions.
100%.
So that's going to happen. Don't get fooled by this 5-0.
He will throw 100 interception if he's throwing 85 touchdowns. Right. Keep it on moving. Cardinals, Titans, your thoughts?
Man, the Cardinals looked good.
Oh, my goodness. You're kind of setting me up, you asshole.
You're welcome.
Taylor Lewan, Pro Bowl tackle, absolutely manhandled.
Yeah.
By Chandler Jones. And the reason why I bring this up, first off, for the tune of 5 sacks.
5 sacks. What the fuck?
5 sacks.
Crazy.
You know who Minnesota plays next week?
Go ahead and let us know.
Arizona Cardinals.
Woof.
In Arizona.
Ouch.
And he'd be going up against our swing tackle, not our stud tackle that we just paid. So could he start off the season with 10 sacks in 2 games? There's a high possibility of it, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, definitely.
Especially the way Kirk Cousins holds that fucking ball back there.
Yep.
So,
yeah, this was crazy to see the Titans struggle this much. And this is why I think you have to play some of your guys in the preseason, right? Not only get them a little bit game ready and feel the game, but my goodness, they just come out and look so bad, right? You add Julio, you think you got the pieces for a Super Bowl run, hopes are high, and then boom, week 1 crush. Which we all thought the Cardinals would be a little better, right, this year and starting to kind of get it figured out. But for a Titans team who thought they're Super Bowl contenders to come out and get smashed like that,
those Cardinals are going to be better than those sea chickens. I know Nanny's on board with I'm Seahawks. So
yes.
Yep.
There's no way that the Seahawks play as good as this team right here, especially defensively.
Yeah, that's...
No, I unpopular opinion maybe, but I think when you mention preseason, I think the starters have to play a game.
You have to play them. I think we saw, you know, a bunch of injuries, guys even going out for a few plays, going to the locker room, this and that, IVs. It's like you've got to play them at least one game, I feel like. Mm-hmm. Also to see if you're gelling, right? To see if you're gelling in a live live game. Like, I know that, okay, defenses play a shell coverage and they don't show, but still, to get together and gel in a game, I think you have to play at least one.
Yeah, you've got to get not only get used to the game speed and all of that, but you've got to get used to taking the hits, too.
Yeah.
You can't jump into game one. Now, I don't know the numbers, but I really would think since they reduced the amount of contact and they reduced the amount of playing time in the preseason, I think injuries are higher now in this early parts of the season than they had been in the past.
So, yeah, I agree with you. I also think the coaches are getting... Well, the CBA also protects these players in camp. How much contact they can take in camp? How many helmet, you know, padded practices there are? So, and Lord knows, I know Zimmer got soft. He never gives up a practice. That any practice that you can get during training camp, he does not give them up. He takes them to the max on those. I think it happened twice. You know, I wonder how many of those teams did the same thing where they let. You know, let their team off, or they let some of these guys sit. But I had read something more interesting when it comes to like these, especially soft tissue injuries. It isn't necessarily about getting hit and playing time. It's actually because all these guys are super jacked. It's not good. It's not good for your muscles. Like you get, as in your soft tendons. It's. I mean, you look great. You can run fast. You can jump high. Well, your body isn't used to be carrying, putting that much tension on all of your stuff. So all these guys like a DK, you've seen what he looks like with his shirt off. You know, I'm just saying.
Like that. Me when I take mine off?
Something like that. Dad bod. We talked about that before.
You know my wife's got expectations. I got to keep them up there.
Right. So I'm not getting ready to overreact on the Titans yet. I think the Cardinals, I think they're going to play like that anyways.
Kyler looked so good.
Yeah, and so did DeAndre.
Damn.
DeAndre looked like DeAndre with an actual quarterback.
Yep.
You know, so I think they're going to be a serious contender, at least in their division for sure. That's going to be a very interesting.
That division race is going to be tough.
Is that the only division that went undefeated?
Yes, I believe so.
I think they all 4-1. So. Yep. Yeah. So, you know. Another one we gotta get to is Browns Chiefs.
Good game, yep.
This game was at one point was that 22-3? I see it by the quarter, but me and you we all looked at it when we were at the party. I thought it was like 22-3 or something like that. I mean,
right? What hurt these guys was getting shut out in that third quarter. You've got to put points up, right? You put 8-14. You get blanked out in the third. You know against the Chiefs, right? No matter how well your defense is playing, you're going to have to put up points, right? Patrick Mahomes and them can strike
anytime. I got a much simpler one for you. Patty Mahomes being Patty Mahomes, and he needs to be down double digits and he needs to come back and spank you. And then Baker Mayfield being Baker Mayfield. So I don't know if you got to see that play at the end. They still had a fighting.
That was horrible.
He did get hit.
Yeah, he did get hit too. But
at that point,
throwing the ground.
Exactly. Thank you. Throw it short into the ground in the direction.
Yep.
There's Mike Hughes was the one that intercepted it. Also was a Viking. Also know that he only made one serious good play with the Vikings. I know if you weren't throwing it right to him, he wasn't going to pick that off. Throw it to the ground. Yep. Live to fight another down.
Yep, absolutely. Because it was first down, I believe.
It was.
That was a shot to the heart there. Tyreek Hill, 197 yards on 11 catches and a touch. Just balling, right? Chiefs ball. Their offense can roll. Still no run game, but.
Did we overhype the Browns defense something? I understand it's the Chiefs. Don't get me wrong. I do understand it's the Chiefs, but Myles Garrett and Jadeveon almost killed Mahomes.
I saw that pancake
which, fucking smash.
Old boy took it too big of a drop, but yeah, he got pancaked. He got fucking killed at the end of his drop. Yeah,
like Mahomes didn't bounce anywhere because two of the biggest men in the NFL smashed him at the exact same time from opposite directions. Yeah. So, but that being said, did we maybe overthink it outside of or overhype him a little bit on defense? I mean, they had the pass rush, I guess, with two studs, but.
Yeah, hold them to a field goal in the first and a touchdown in the second. I mean, that's – you got to be happy with your defense.
Yeah, interesting. I mean, when you look at the stats, Baker Mayfield, efficient, 21 to 28, 321, but he didn't throw a touchdown.
Mm-mm.
And the leading receiver had – it was Njoku, who had 76 yards. Like, if they could get Beckham back and he actually gels with the team, that could have made a big difference in this game. And they could have pulled that out, I think. It just says so much about how they rely on this run game. Kind of like the opposite with Buffalo, right? Too much on the pass game. I think they've got to be able to get Baker some touchdowns here.
Right, because especially against the Chiefs. The talent is there, right, on the pass catching side. Njoku, you got Higgins, Rashard Higgins, right? Jarvis Landry, Odell obviously out.
Yeah, I mean, so you got Hooper.
Donovan Peoples-Jones, he can ball out. So, yeah, you definitely got to open it up a little bit more to a passing offense. Now, you know, don't want to lose your identity. You're run first team, run. But, yeah, you got to involve the pass game a little more. So, that was a really good game. Enjoyed that. Browns are going to be tough. Chiefs, of course.
Yeah, that was one hell of a good game to start the year off right there. I got to touch on it a little bit. Teddy Two Gloves, you know, I was hating on him a little bit. You know, and hating on them is a strong word. I just meant like I don't feel like there's like a Super Bowl contender with them. They're a playoff team with them.
You did say you thought they could win the division, though.
Yeah. I said what did I say? Last to first, best shot.
Mm-hmm.
And can they still do it? Yeah, they could. The Chiefs also showed one thing they did show in that game. They also showed their issues, their deficiencies. I don't think they had pressure on Mayfield until the second half. You know, they showed some little bit of weaknesses there. This offensive line is still, for the Chiefs, are still learning to gel together. You don't just throw, yes, they're way better than they were last year, but everybody knows it takes time for an offensive line to build continuity and to become a unit. It's one thing to substitute one guy out or two guys or something like that, not basically the whole offensive line. So that takes a little bit of time. So that's one of their growing pain weaknesses, which I assume will get better throughout the year. But that being said, Denver Broncos they'd win 27-13. Melvin Gordon had a 70-yard touchdown run. I think he was trying to prove that he still got it. Like Javonte, go ahead and stay on the bench over there.
Yeah, I mean, before that run, he had 10 attempts for, what, like 30 yards?
Yeah.
So that game was really more you like 20-13, which is way too close for me when you're playing the Giants. I have the opposite take.
I told you. 9-8, baby.
I didn't think Denver looked that good. Teddy looked fine. But it did hurt. Judy getting hurt, right? He'll be out for a while.
Well, these are the games that you're going to get, though. When you have Teddy Bridgewater throwing as your quarterback, this is the games you're going to be in.
Right.
He's not going to blow the top off. He's not going to shoot you into – so that run, take that run away like you said.
Right. Melvin's 70-yarder.
Yep.
Yeah.
But first off, I don't like to do that because if we take all away every big run, Barry Sanders would be below average running back. So
that's
so
a fair point.
So we need to be careful with that. 1-1-2, -5, and then 65-yard touchdown. That's what also made him special.
Right,
so.
But he's not going to – right. Melvin's not going to put up crazy yards.
No, I don't think so either. But I just mean like if you do this, you do that. What I'm getting at is we do know what Teddy is. These are the games that you will be in. Let's say the 70-yarder doesn't happen. There's a hold. 20-13. Those are what the games are going to be. I told you they have one of the top defenses in the league. So these games are going to be like this. This is how they're – if when they win, this is how they're going to be on a consistent basis. So, yes, the Jerry Jeudy thing's going to hurt. He showed some continuity with him. I mean – you know,
what, he had eight targets before that?
Chris better hope and pray that you know, actually you don't want it to end right now, but this is going to, this looks like this bet's going to be in the bag here. That's how much connection these two players have, which is too bad. You know, I did tell you I love Cortland, and I had him on my team last year too.
Okay, he was on a pitch count last night, so I'm not too worried here. You know, nursing him back from that ACL injury, so.
I did want to bring up one more before we get to the Sunday night game, which was entertaining. A little revenge game. Sam Darnold against them Jets, right?
Yeah, the lower scoring game than, you know, I potentially had that being a high scoring affair. Not the case. Nice for him to get a little revenge, right?
Yeah.
And hooking up two Jet, former Jets hooking up for a long touchdown as well.
I mean, he had a good if decent day, 24-35, 279 and a touch. You know, didn't hurt his team. Got himself a little bit of revenge there, and Christian McCaffrey came back looking Christian McCaffrey-esque. I think he still has a little more on the tank than what he showed, but, I mean, you'll definitely take that for a day between his receiving yards and his rushing yards. And then Corey Davis, I think we were both kind of – I think all three of us kind of touched on it, but I know me and you were talking about it. Corey Davis had 97 and two tutties.
Right, five receptions. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, not a bad debut for Zach Wilson either. He had a couple touchdowns. I don't know. I like Sam Darnold. I think they're going to just gel more and more. I think they're going to be a pretty solid team this year. Nothing spectacular, but, it's funny you say that. McCaffrey has more in the tank. He had almost 200 all-purpose yards, so
yeah,
we'll take that on a bad day.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? But what I'm saying, don't you feel like there'd be like almost another touchdown in there somewhere usually with him? And yeah. Oh, I'll take it, though. I do believe I'm taking care of business and fantasy so far, so. Protecting my hair.
It's right? Not a hair if you don't have the championship belt.
Oh, I will. No, it's protecting the hair bet.
Oh, the hair bet. Yeah, the okay,
hair.
Yeah.
Protecting the hair.
Definitely.
Because my wife said she listened to that episode. She was not happy with that wager.
Yeah.
She's like, if you come in this house with a bald head, you can't hear. I cannot tell you the rest of what was said.
So I did this when you threw that cornhole game and we had that haircut and bet. And Jimmer was my teammate, threw the game and then cut my own hair. Like, my own teammate cut my hair. So anyways, but I go home, right?
You're leaving details out, but keep going.
No, that's exactly how that went pretty much. Jump in bed, just cover my head because I'm like, this is not going to go well. Because I, you know, didn't tell my wife at all. And she's talking to me, and I'm just kind of like pretending I'm asleep. And she like uncovers. She goes, "What the fuck?" I'm like, "Yeah, man. Hair's falling out.
Hair's falling out."
Yeah, your wife is a smart woman to be scared because she knows.
No, she's not scared. She's like, "You better not." And she knows better because I'm consistently in the money. So there's one thing I can. There's a few things you can bank on in life, and that's death, taxes, and me being hanging for a championship.
You know, nobody here has gotten the toilet bowl trophy, I do believe. So that's a weird statement to make.
Yeah. No one else here also has won the championship three times. So sometimes you got to feel a little bit of humility and, you know, get brought back down to earth every so often. But now that I had a taste of that, enough of that shit. We'll just go ahead and wrap up this chip.
Well, now that the old Reverend Kevin and Jay ain't here to consistently be in the running for the toilet bowl
trophy. So that's got
to
be Tyler then?
It's got to be Tyler this year. Oh, absolutely. TK, shout out to you and your horrible fantasy team.
Horrible fantasy
team. We may be battling for it this year. I did not look great week one.
That being said, I think we need to get to this Rams-Bears game. It looked like
MVP, baby.
Yeah, it's like anyone that was chuckling and has been talking shit about your dark horse, Will Arnold there. Or was it Will? Was it Will that I told you that he was
I know Luke wasn't a big fan.
Oh, maybe it was Luke. Okay. Maybe Will was on board. I had to leave that one alone, but it almost looked video.
20 of 26, 321, three picks.
Right.
Effortless. And that Bears defense isn't bad.
Right. I mean,
no.
Look at Eddie
Dude,
Jackson.
It looked like a video game.
Yeah.
Like every pass was 50 yards. Every touchdown seemed like it was 50 yards downfield. He should have had another deep one that Cooper Kupp should have had, and I guess he got tripped up there. And Darrell Henderson ended up taking it in. But, you know, sky's the limit, dude. They didn't even – the defense didn't even really ball out in this game.
Yeah, no.
They really didn't. I mean,
only three sacks.
The Bears were moving the ball up and down the field. They really were. They just weren't putting it in the end zone.
Mm-hmm.
David Montgomery made them look like they are not the top rushing defense in the league, which we're used to seeing. 108 yards and a touchdown.
Well, they played real soft
on 16 carries.
If you watching the game, they weren't up on the line of scrimmage. It was four down guys. They were conceding. Okay, you can run whatever. Go ahead.
Nobody said it. Weird. They had to intentionally bring up Aaron Donald's name. That's how quiet he was in this game.
Yeah, until the last play of the game, I think he finally got a sack.
Did he finally get one? Yep. Okay, I didn't see the last play, but they had to make a point of just talking like, hey, it's been real weird that we haven't said his name. And
He had a lot of pressures, but he was in the pocket, moving, creating havoc, just couldn't finish the play, Dalton slip out of his hands. On one of the plays in the third, I believe it was, he had him and went for the strip instead and ended up falling down, whiffed on the, because he whiffed on the swipe, fell down, and then his teammate ended up getting the sacks.
Hey, I'm going to be honest with you, though. I don't think this Bears defense is anywhere near what we're used to seeing anymore. I could barely recognize any of the names out there, when they were announcing the starting lineup, how they do that. And, like, only a few of them. I was like, oh, okay, yeah. We know the normals. We know Robert Quinn. We know Khalil Mack. Maybe Sean even Gibson. Ogletree.
Ogletree is a
yeah, but some of these other guy. Ones, some of these other guys, like the corners, are not anywhere near as intimidating as what they have had in the past. So I don't think they're going to.
Yeah.
But that being said, the Rams are still – all they did was help ensure – I don't even think this is an overreaction. I think they just help secure my confidence in them going to the Super Bowl.
Yeah. Also, my MVP vote, man. Stafford looked darn good, leading that offense.
Yep. So we thinking about touching a little bit on some of these close college games that happened.
Yeah, let's move over. I think the rest of the NFL games are just kind of. I don't think we need to touch on them too much. The we didn't touch on the – well, we did a little bit, right, the Texans?
Yeah. Come on. That's
not
waste,
was,
not
that was their time. Super Bowl. Yeah, they get them twice. So.
Hey, proud of you. You're not going 0-17. You may get a second win if Jacksonville plays like that again and when you guys play again later on this season.
Yeah. They're still going to be bad.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, let's move over to college.
So – I think I had them as a. I had them to cover, Toledo
against Notre Dame. That's what 2 weeks in a row now, because didn't they play Oklahoma week one and gave them lost by five?
Yeah, and then even vice versa, Notre Dame back to back close victories. In fact, enough to where it dropped them down.
What I say? Ranking. Notre Dame always overrated. Texas too, but
yep,
always
name.
Yeah. Yep, just the name. Falling in love with the name and the hype and whatnot. Yeah, I can. They're, going to be given a lot of problems this year, I think. Texas A&M, that was another surprise against a bad Colorado team. Did not look very good.
No.
18 of 38, their quarterback, 18 of 38 for only 183 yards.
I did vaguely bring them up. But, I didn't say, I was like, I'm kind of leaning towards this Colorado thing as, a potential upset. But, could have pulled the trigger, but God. Too close for comfort right there, right? I mean,
did not take the lead till the fourth quarter.
Till the fourth quarter. Down 7-3 up until the four. So some of the ones that helped my dark horse. I can't remember if I even said dark horse. They might have been in my college football playoff. USC, number 14, get stomped out by Stanford.
Yeah. That's
in fact, it wasn't even as close as it looks. I mean, they put up 15 of those 28 in the fourth.
We always talked, right? We talked about USC. They're my pick. It's like, maybe this is the year they finally kind of get it together. You did bring up Stanford playing tough. USC just always disappoints, right?
They do.
Just for some reason.
Well, as soon as, Pete Carroll takes his takes all the illegal benefits with him into the NFL, things just kind of never came back, right?
Yeah.
That's what's going to happen. It's looking like Oregon and UCLA over there, man. That's,
You already mentioned earlier BYU, Utah. That was I don't know if any of us were surprised, but you did call it. You did call the upset on that. So North Carolina rebounded nicely, and so did Sam Howell. I understand it's only Georgia State, but you definitely needed that after being upset. So, yeah. Sam Howell, 352 and 3. So,
yeah, we'll take that. He needed a bounce back game, as did North Carolina.
What does, because Michigan did win, right?
I believe they did. Yes.
Okay. What does Ohio State, if they even still have a shot, what do they have to do to make it to the college football playoff? Is it enough to where they go to the Big Ten championship and win?
Well, so here's the thing. If Oregon just rolls, which, you know, I see them doing it, you've got to start blowing out all these guys. You got a big matchup against Penn State, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you got to win convincingly there, which I don't know if they do. That's going to be a tough game. And then you have Michigan to end. So their schedule sets them up to rebound nicely, yes, but you're going to have to put up points in these games.
Yep.
So schedule-wise, yes, I think it's favorable for them, but you're also rooting for Oregon to not have any slip-ups, you know, and to race to that Pac-12 title. So, and to get back in.
Yep. Well, you're at that, and you're rooting for Oregon to not just only not slip up. You're actually rooting for them to actually throttle everyone they play, too, because then you're lost. Yeah. You only lost by 7.
Right.
Even though it was at home. So.
Yep, early. That's going to help you, right?
Yeah, it depends on how things go, I think, because – so Oklahoma just – what did they drop this weekend? 76?
Yeah.
So,
yeah, there was no holds barred in that.
Yeah, if Oklahoma keeps doing that, if Oregon keeps winning, I don't think Ohio State has a shot. I don't think anybody in the Big Ten does.
Whoa. If Iowa State's undefeated, you got to.
Yikes.
You have to, though, right?
If they can win the Big 12 Big Ten.
They would have to, right?
And go undefeated and win the Big Ten title, which we can talk about how they – suck at closing the deal, right?
Well, we can actually just overlook their schedule here or take a look at it. You have, I think, one of the scariest matchups for them actually is, yeah, you have Penn State. That Penn State game is at home. You have at Wisconsin. Wisconsin always, we're always like the little brother to them, it seems like. But
it'd be tough games. But
Wisconsin, that quarterback has not looked good.
No, not at all.
And against this defense, I mean, they've played two better quarterbacks than what Wisconsin is producing right now. Other than that, the one game that actually scares me that is not ranked right now, I don't think they became ranked either, is Maryland. Tua's brother leading the charge there. They have an offense.
Yeah.
They play some pretty damn good defense, and it's at Maryland too. So I need to be careful on that because I think that's also set up for a – overlook game because I do believe Penn State is after that. Yeah.
Yeah.
So Maryland's 2-0, and yeah, and Penn State at home is the week after. So that's one hell of a trap game. And what I mean by one hell of a trap game is that Maryland knows how to play some offense. So
right. Well, another one I think you may be overlooking, I'm just saying it because where it falls last, Nebraska, you know, potential rivalry.
That's enough.
Right.
That's enough. Anyway.
No, that's enough. No, I'm saying just so if y'all are undefeated, right? I could see, you know, if y'all are coming undefeated, you're looking ahead to the Big Ten championship game. You come because it's at Nebraska.
Maybe.
They're playing, you know, their championship or their Super Bowl, whatever.
I'm not disagreeing with anything you're really saying. I'm really not because you're not wrong in the aspect of you. If you're right there and the eyes are big.
Mm-hmm.
But there's no way. I'm sorry.
Iowa's the better team by far.
Well, no. I just mean, like, literally, Nebraska was a forced rivalry that they tried to, like, make happen because we're like, side by side.
Right. So here's the thing. It's going to mean more for them, even if they're out of any potential bowl game or whatever. It's going to mean a lot to them.
It's going to mean a lot to them. It's not going to mean more to them. More to us going into the Big Ten championship, if that happens at that point,
right,
is a hell of a lot bigger.
Sure, and that's why I'm just saying it. Potential game to just keep an eye on if Iowa rolls there and undefeated, and you're looking at a, you know, championship berth or, you know, championship aspirations, especially college playoff. Just wanted to keep an eye on.
I'm with you 100%, though. Unable to, like, to even have this conversation, I think, first off, you can't count on defensive touchdowns, and now we've gotten 28 points off of defense.
Yeah.
So you can't count on that. You need quarterback play. You need the respect of and it doesn't benefit or help my guy Tyler Goodson. I'm huge on, but it doesn't help when nobody respects that passer back there.
Yeah.
So like I said, we'll see how she goes. Me and Danny are used to our favorite teams letting us down, and that's usually Vikings and Hawkeyes. So,
Bama, roll tide, baby.
I don't think it'll be Nebraska, but we do tend to have a dumb game or two where we lose when we definitely shouldn't.
Yep.
So there'll be one or two of those on there. But going back to the original thing, right? Big Ten making it to the college football playoff. I don't know if that happens this year.
Yeah, the way Georgia that's the thing. Two SEC teams are getting in, Georgia, Alabama. They just look too darn good.
Maybe, maybe not. And what I mean by that is, like, they would have to split.
Yeah, yes.
They would have to split.
Yeah, I think they have to split.
If one of them, let's say it's the only two losses they have is against, like, let's say Georgia, and Georgia loses to Bama twice, I still, even if they're close, I still don't think it's that. You can't do that to a Big Ten team if they're undefeated. You can't do that.
If they're undefeated.
I don't think there's going to be an undefeated Big Ten team. That's what I'm saying.
There could be Rutgers.
Rutgers, baby.
Shit.
Sleeper.
Here's what's more likely to me, okay? I think it's more likely that the Pac-12
sneaks one in
gets
there.
Gets another one besides Oregon.
Someone, no.
Oh, no way.
No,
no
first
way.
Off, whoa.
No.
Whoa.
I can see if the Ducks roll, I can see the Ducks getting in. Oh, my goodness.
A.
Stop saying ridiculous things.
You say
UCLA.
Please.
I'm telling you right now, I like what I've seen from Oregon. Oregon is not going undefeated. The Pac-12 will not put one in the college football playoff because they won't. Their team has to go undefeated.
Yeah,
and Oregon, blow everybody out.
They have to. For whatever reason, the college football committee has already shown this plenty of times over this
because it's a weak conference.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean,
so there's no way Oregon's not going undefeated.
So here's the deal: Oklahoma's going to lose to Iowa State. They're not going to go undefeated. The Big 12's out.
Oklahoma's not losing to Iowa
State. Not losing to Iowa State.
No, they're not.
So they're going to lose to Iowa State.
So I'm an Iowa State.
You want to go a
guy,
bet on
I guess, this. But yeah, I'm feeling.
Nah,
right.
You
once,
know,
once a week comes
I
up, we might do that.
Texas, no. So Texas, maybe. Texas is still growing with their coach. Oklahoma is not losing to Iowa State.
Right. Iowa State cannot match that offense no matter what.
No.
Yeah, anyway, we'll talk about that once the week comes. But so Big 12 team, there no Big 12 team is going to be undefeated. No Big 10 team is going to be undefeated. And there could be two, I don't know how the schedules line up in the Pac-12. But Oregon is right now, they're in, right?
They play, UCLA and Oregon do.
They play together?
They play
at one point?
They play, yep.
Okay, so that could be the difference then. If they play each other, then there won't be two.
No, there won't be a difference here. Oregon's not going undefeated.
Okay. Well,
I mean, there's potential there if they can get past a good-looking UCLA team, but
Oregon's really good, Jimmer. So whiskey wager that Oregon makes it to the college football playoffs right now.
Okay.
Get it down.
That's the easiest
whiskey
one I've ever done.
Whiskey wager
warm,
right now.
Warm whiskey wager.
Warm whiskey wager.
Warm
let's
go.
Whiskey wager. Yeah, I hate doing this only because I borderline like Oregon, but they don't have. They're not going to go undefeated. So we've already stated they have to go undefeated in the Pac-12 to go. So yeah, if you're 100% confident, let's whiskey wager this shit.
Let's go.
It's on.
Put it in the
books.
There's
mine. Yep. Let's go ahead and get that action. That's a
Okay. Danny, what are you saying? Oregon is not going to be in?
No, Oregon will be in the college football.
Says Oregon will be in.
Yeah. So basically saying they're going to be undefeated, though, in so many words, too.
Yeah, I think their biggest struggle will be that UCLA game. Whenever
their biggest struggle will be their quarterback, who was 17 at 35.
Yeah.
That run game is what kept them going. And their defense.
Absolutely.
Right, he didn't play well,
it's their defense.
Beat up Ohio State.
Beat up's a strong word.
They did.
They won by 7.
Yeah, that's not beat up.
Yeah, with a freshman quarterback. If this game was later
at
in the
season. Ohio State.
If this game was later in the season, towards, you know, maybe the not the second game of the season for a freshman quarterback, this might have been a different outcome.
Freshman quarterback still having to get used to a crowd, regardless if it's your own or not.
Yeah.
It's still a massive
crowd. I do appreciate you trying to get drunk on the set, though. I do. I really do. Yeah. No.
So, do you want to double down on that and say Oregon's going undefeated? Because that's the only way they're going.
You have to.
I got to see their schedule. We'll talk about that.
Well, you'd have to because
that's the only way they get in.
If that's what it takes, then they'll be undefeated. Yeah, I think they're going to get in.
Okay, so you're going to double down with them and say another shot because they got to be undefeated.
That's not a double down. I'm saying if you guys are saying that they're going to make – if in order to get to the college football playoffs, they have to be undefeated, then
that's
part of the bet.
Right? That's what we think. You say they get in regardless, all right?
I'm saying they get in, yeah.
So they played impressively, and their defense, they're not used to having defenses like this. I will say that.
They're really talented all around, man.
Are they? Are they really super, super awesome?
I'm telling you, they beat up Ohio State, man.
Listen, when you go to a team, what the Eagles did to the Falcons, they beat the Falcons up.
In college football, if you travel to a place like Ohio State, and you beat them at home by 7 points, that's beating them up because you already have a 7 to 10 point advantage just because of that home crowd.
What Arkansas did to Texas, that's fucking beat up.
Would you like me to help you out?
Yes, Arkansas thumped Texas.
Would you like me to help you in this argument right now? I can help you. Say, Jimmer, I need your help.
I'm not going to do that.
You're saying it with your eyes right now.
I'm not going
to
do that.
You look like you're about to cry, Danny.
You know the one thing you could have said right out of the gate? They were 14.5-point underdogs.
Right.
And then they won by 7. So that's a 21-point swing just off of. Okay. See, I'll help you out. I got you, baby bird. Come underneath this wing.
So you keep saying 7 points isn't beating.
It's not, all my picks, it's not a beatdown. For all you listening out there, all my picks, 100% college picks, baby.
No,
well,
they
I'm at Texas, but.
Quit giving yourself so much credit over
here. What are you talking
about? Yeah. First of all.
Well, I'll go read them right now.
Next time you go say something stupid, you're drinking that whole bottle.
BYU, 7-point underdogs. Boom. Iowa, 4.5 underdogs. Boom. Oregon, 14.5-point underdogs. Boom. BYU knocking off Utah. Boom. Lock it down, baby.
What else? There was one more.
What, my Texas one?
Yeah.
Make sure
you mention that.
What do you mean you had to?
Did I not say? I was like, I could see them losing to Arkansas, but I'm not going to pick my team. I told you that. I was like, I'm not going to pick them as my my upset just because.
I also hit on both of my Stone Cold locks. Let's make that perfectly clear. I took Rutgers -2.5.
There you go.
And Toledo +16.5.
Yep. Toledo looking strong against a strong schedule.
My pro one went 2-for-3.
I don't think it was Toledo.
Did the Dolphins win?
Toledo's one. No, it's Toledo's 1-1. So I don't.
Oh, okay.
Did we overlook that? Dolphins won. What was the score of that?
17-16.
17-16.
Yeah, it was real close.
I hit on San Diego State. Iowa missed on the Buffalo +13.5 at Nebraska.
Okay.
So not. I don't think any of us really went undefeated if you count. Yeah. So
you were right, Danny. That's Tulane.
Tulane.
Okay. I can't remember what your bets were on it, but actually we all did pretty well. So
yeah, we
did. That being said, I gotta touch on Conor McGregor.
Oh boy,
video out of him throwing a drink at Machine Gun Kelly.
Just trying to stay relevant.
This is, I'm gonna tell you right now, that's what you think, but I'm going the other way. This is what happens when you speak illy of proper number 12. Who the fuck is this guy? I have no idea. No matter. I guarantee you, he said, your whiskey sucks. Oh, yeah.
Shout out, Connor. We got a bottle of proper 12 here.
We do.
On the table, so.
Some of that proper.
Yeah, I don't know. I think cocaine is a hell of a drug.
Right. Cause,
make it recreational already. Jeez.
Yeah, right. Just a little, a couple bumps of recreational cocaine. This guy is. So if it's not drugs, the biggest mood swings I've ever seen in my life. Yeah. I don't know if you've ever seen. I know you have for sure. Oh yeah, you both have seen it. God, I was thinking of the wrong movie. Happy Gilmore. Remember when he's yelling into the apartment headset at his girlfriend upstairs, and then no, honey, I just want to make sweet love to you. You know, I wanna kiss you all over. So they're going back and forth. Yeah, you know what? I seen those finger paintings and they suck. Kind of like Connor. Because right after this, he's going to say he's sorry or whatever. You know, it wasn't quite what it looks like. And, you know, I really love Justin Poirier. And,
yeah,
you know, Khabib's the man. And he's then
he already tried that. You know, he tried the humble route. Their first fight with Poirier, right? And then he lost and got knocked out. And I think he figured out that's not for him. What he needs to do is just go fight Jake Paul, man. Make some quick money. Yeah. But please, oh, please, just knock his ass out.
For the love of God.
Somebody. Just knock him out.
And don't hug him afterwards. I'm so sick and tired of these. So I understand it's a respect thing. But when you sit there and jaw jack and hate each other and talk about each other's mothers and you're that pissed off because of it, why in the fuck is there any type of appreciation after that?
Yeah, no kidding.
You know, get the hell out of here.
Yeah, it turns like, into
honestly,
shit.
You might as well smack him one more time after the bell already rang at that point. Don't go ahead and stir it up for the next one. Let's stop sitting there sucking ass. You're not supposed to. You guys claim you didn't like each other. You hated each other. This is every fighter. And then all of a sudden we're going to sit here and, you know, pound it out and do the old fucking movie Chips thing where groins are touching each other and shit like bros and get the hell out of here.
Yeah, related note, it sounds like Jake Paul's looking at Fury's brother for the next fight.
He said he wants a legit boxer for his next one, and they said Fury's undefeated.
Okay. Yeah, you know, maybe that's what it's going to take, a guy who's kind of unknown-ish, you know, and not like celebrity type, you know, like a name. Woodley's a name. Sure. Yeah, so Fury, but his brother's got his name.
I agree with you. But exactly. So I'm agreeing with you 1,000%. Because Fury is, I don't know if it's a sideshow for Jake. I think he takes it semi-serious, but most of it's about money, right? Fury is like trying to build onto his own thing. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, this is his career.
Right, his boxer.
We are boxers. Right. Like, I am a boxer.
Well, not a guy about to bow out or, you know, retire.
That's what I'm getting
soon.
At. Yeah, he's not. Right. He's trying to build a leg. Like,
just,
trying to build
just
up
to be
it.
Clear, though, that's not his career. That's not his trade. Like, Fury's brother isn't a boxer by trade. He got famous because of a reality show. So he has some boxing matches, like, similar to what Jake Paul does, I assume, but that's not what he does. So don't just so we're not overhyping it. He's not a boxer like that. Is my point.
There's not very many like his brother, but
well, so you're saying he wants to go against a legit boxer. I'm saying he's not quite that, but it is getting you closer to that, I guess.
Okay.
Right?
So I'm not saying you could be, and you probably are 100% right because I don't know. Mm-hmm. This is purely coming out of his own mouth, not Fury's the other one. So. I guess I didn't know that.
Yeah.
The name got my attention.
Yeah, 100%.
So we are getting into the final parts of this episode here. And we are going to start closing around like we normally do. And it is time for Make Sense if you don't think about it. And it is unofficially sponsored by Michelob Golden Light.
So it's supposed to be Danny's turn, but I'll go ahead and go this one. Nice, short, and sweet one. My boy, the Reverend Kevin Sharp. He, funny guy. He says some crazy stuff. Sometimes I'm not quite sure if he knows. He's just rambling off. But he's a Bears fan, right? And one day, you know, all week he's talking. I can't remember who they're playing. He's like, the Bears are going to smack that ass, you know, right? He's just hyping them up. And then it was a good game. They ended up losing by, like, on a last-second field goal or something like that. So lose by 3 and come in. You know, we're kind of razzing him a little bit. He's like, yeah, well, if the Bears had scored more points, they would have won. Dead serious. Like, 100%. This is his argument. The Bears won when they scored more points. So, ladies and gentlemen, it makes sense if you don't think about it.
It makes sense if you don't think about it.
Oh,
good Lord.
Man,
I do miss me some K Sharp.
Yes, yes, we do.
Man, between that and the kicker for trade baits, this man's got some gems.
Oh, he does got some gems.
I was going to say, you have no idea how easily, and maybe we kind of get like that, but when you get someone that is not ready for a true razzing of sports and they're passionate about their team, they go out and say just ridiculous.
No, I get it. I once said Alabama wasn't a dynasty. I was,
yes, you did.
That's
you
not
did.
What I was trying to say. But
no,
I,
that is
I
what
was,
you said.
Right.
You
that's what came out, but that's not where I was going. I was getting hammered by Luke and Jimmer from both sides, and that's the only thing that come out. And then, you know, you got to stick your guns, right? So I'm trying to defend it.
He's trying to defend it. I'm like, how? We both stop. Like, how in the hell is that not considered a dynasty?
Then when we get out of the heat of the moment, I'm like, okay, watch. I think what I was trying to say was, like, they weren't a dynasty like USC was back in the day with stars, like, walking the sidelines and stuff.
Yeah.
But it just did not come out anywhere close to that.
So what's he do to try to – his last-ditch effort. Yeah. His last-ditch effort. And now I'm going to slaughter this because I can't remember which region he said.
I think
but
it was
he said
Western
Alabama isn't one. We go and look this up.
They like Western, won their conference and shit. Like,
yeah, they have
years
yeah, they have a championship in their own.
Oh
conference,
man, yeah, they were just like winners all around too.
Yeah,
I'm like,
he's
well,
like,
fuck me, right?
He can't even try to bail out of it. Yeah,
yeah.
Oh, but, that's
so
awesome.
Y'all get a double dose of makes sense if you don't think about it. There
you
go.
Love it.
Just double dipping.
All right. Well, thank you everyone for listening. Give us a follow on all the socials. 3Gig on Facebook, Instagram. Check us out on YouTube.
TikTok.
We're going to be putting out some pretty good shit, especially after this weekend on TikTok. These boys have an interesting golf game. I don't know if we brought that up.
Go ahead.
You guys are doing it. Go ahead.
So me and Jimmer and our buddy Luke and Jared, we are playing in a golf tournament, but it's no ordinary golf tournament, right? It is a beer-drinking golf tournament. And by what I mean by that is every beer that you drink is a stroke off your golf score.
Yeah, this is Jimmer's time to shine, baby.
Well, we know his time to shine wasn't when you just had to hit ball with the club.
No,
make it in the
not.
Hole.
This sets him up. This is our legit shot of
winning something.
A golf tournament. Not a flight in there, the actual chip. It's a four-person beer scramble. So it doesn't matter who's hitting because I'm killing beer.
We can drink our way back into it.
Yeah,
baby.
We're in serious talks about throwing a GoPro on while we do this. So
and uploading it to YouTube. So stay tuned.
Stay tuned for the drunken stupidness.
Yeah, stay tuned. And also give a shout out to our unofficial fake, not really sponsors. Mick Golden Light, today's Proper 12.
Proper 12, baby.
Proper 12, Connor.
Let's go.
The Notorious.
All righty, beautiful. Well, catch us later this week for some updates and previews of the weekend. Bye-bye.